You are listening to 105.9 FM, The Radiator, WOMMLP Burlington, and now starts Rocket Shop Radio Hour. And tonight we have the musical comedy duo, Pony Death Ride. Pony Death Ride, how are you tonight?
We're great. Thanks for having us.
Of course. So, would you kind of just like to describe who you are, state your name and what you're playing or singing tonight, and then we'll kick it off with a song.
Okay. We are Pony Death Ride, the half-Canadian married musical comedy duo. It's a mouthful. We are inspired by old-timey vaudeville musical comedy, and we enjoy the holidays, so we have special songs that we like to sing around this time of year. Joe, anything else to add?
Nope, you covered it all.
Perfect. So what
song? If you hear the songs, you won't necessarily think we like the holidays, but we do once we started performing the songs. Before that, it was not. But now it is.
There you go. So what do you have for us for your first song tonight?
Well, we were told to keep it clean. We don't have a lot of those songs, so we're doing a cover by Garfunkel and Oates, another comedy duo.
Just to help ease everyone into our own original music, it's a nice segue. Make people like us first, and then we'll see how it goes by the second song.
This song is called Present Face.
Christmas comes but once a year, and mostly it is swell. But there's an epidemic that I think we all know well. Your smile is frozen open, there's a crazed look in your eye. You overflow with compliments while trying to deny that you loathe the gift you've opened, though you try to keep your grace. Your scary grin is frozen, don't you know you've got a case of present face, present face. Present face.
Oh, thanks for the gift.
I love it.
You really hoped your parents would give you a great big check. Instead, you got a puffy painted hummingbird turtleneck. And you hope for an engagement ring inside that tiny box. But your stupid former future husband only bought you socks. Now your face is all contorted as you're trying to erase the truth behind your smile. Don't you know you've got a case of present face? Present face. Present face, present face.
Oh, I just saw the gift you got me. It's a gift,
oh,
all right?
Good, I'm glad you like it. I was so worried you wouldn't like it.
Oh, no, it's a...
Oh, that's good, because, you know, I was up really late. I was hitting the bottle a little, taking a few pills. I saw this ad come on TV, and I thought... Mm-hmm. He would love that.
Yeah, that makes sense. Most good decisions are made at 3 in the morning with a mouthful of pills. So I appreciate the effort you put into this gift, and I'll make sure to put it where everybody can see it.
Oh, good. I'm so glad you like it.
Do they see
how much I hate it? I hope that they don't know. I can't tell if they're onto it. Oh, please don't let it show. Baby Jesus got some gold, which all infants prefer. But I bet he got the present face with frankincense and myrrh. Christmas and his birthday are both on the 25th. It must have sucked to have to open combination gifts. But if Jesus couldn't hide it from his omnipresent face, then you and I are doomed to an everlasting case of present face.
Thanks.
Present face, I love it.
Present face. It smells a little funny.
It's a little
present
wet. Present face.
Thanks so much. Can't wait till next year.
Thank you.
Ta-da! I thought they were going to clap.
No.
I thought...
Oh!
They have to... Like any good audience, they need to be told one thing.
Right? We need the live studio audience sounds because the comedy is real. So tell us, how did Pony Death Ride begin? What are your backgrounds in music and comedy?
We actually met while both of our rock bands were playing shows.
Oh, wow.
I played guitar and sang for a band, and Jay played the bass in her band. And we just kind of met through that. Our bands would play shows together, and then we started going out. Is that what they say, going out?
Yeah. Any indication of when this was, I'll just say MySpace was popular at the time. Some of you may not remember MySpace.
We chatted on MySpace. And then we were together, and then we both were kind of tired of carrying all these heavy amps and guitars. And I was like, let's just get a ukulele and start our own band. And it was really rough. It was just the two of us. But it's been a blast. I think we've been at it for like 12 years. We have 4 albums, and we tour. At least we tour our Christmas show every year. We did until pandemic.
Gotcha.
And we're new here. Like, we just moved to Vermont a year ago. So we lived in San Diego, and we did a lot of touring around the West Coast and the Midwest and stuff like that. Mm. Now we're here. We don't know very many people, so.
Well, I'm sure you'll get to know everybody very quickly, right?
We do know Billy Bratcher, and he told us he's the only person we need to know. That's his words.
There you go.
He didn't understand.
So you mentioned that, if I'm pronouncing the name correctly, that was by Garfunkel and Oates.
Yes.
Yes.
So I'm guessing that that's a comedic group. Who are some of your other inspirations in terms of comedy?
Well, going way, way back, duos like Burns and Allen back in the, the 40s. More recently, I always kind of blank. We come from rock and roll backgrounds, punk rock sensibility. So bands like the Dead Milkmen are enjoyable, from a comedic standpoint. Joe, any others?
No, you covered
just
it.
Just one inspiration.
the comedy duos from way back, there's not a whole lot of them today, but the ones that are around are good. They're always a source of inspiration. And bands like They Might Be Giants and Dead Milkmen and anything that's kind of wacky and out there.
We've actually been compared to Captain Beefheart before, which is a weird compliment, but I'll take it. We like to travel light, so ukulele, glockenspiel, kazoo. But when we record, we actually do a lot more instrumentation, and the songs are quite a lot more complex, so much so that we actually can't perform a lot of those songs live. So we have sort of a dual sets, let's say.
Gotcha.
The songs we play and the songs we don't play.
Yeah.
Do you at all miss the band scene? I mean, you said that your roots were kind of in doing more of that as opposed to doing the whole comedic route. And would you say that that kind of prepared you in a way to have certain elements of that in what you're doing now?
Definitely. It was great as far as getting comfortable on the stage and just being used to the grind. I enjoy now not having to carry all those heavy instruments. It wasn't that glamorous all the times. There's not a lot of fun in playing on a Tuesday night at like 11:30 to 2 or 3 people in the bar, no matter how much they enjoy you. I enjoy this. It's a lot more immediate, and it helps us appeal to a wider audience. We appeal to people of all ages, kids as well as seniors. We tell people, we're not really appropriate for kids, but somehow their kids get to listen to our records. So it's nice being able to reach a wider audience through a multi-genre approach, I guess.
Gotcha. And so right now you're obviously doing holiday songs, and you mentioned that you do this typically every year around the holiday season?
Yeah, it's been about 8 years now that we just decided to do, somehow, it's like we have an album about cats. Like, we wrote one song about cats. Next thing you know, we're writing an entire record about cats. But Christmas was kind of the same. Like, we wrote a Christmas song. Maybe it was a parody. I don't remember. And then a lot of friends in, like, the burlesque community people like that had these shows, and it's like, great, we can go and play in their show. You know, we've tried to do this act in bars, and it's no one listens. But burlesque shows and shows that are more intimate, people definitely listen, and it's really neat. But so we just started going out on the road with our Christmas show. I mean, it was, you know, from San Diego, where we're from, to Los Angeles, and then we go, you know, we ended up in Seattle or Denver. I mean, we kind of just every year would pick a new area and tour it around, and it was fun. And we, you know, we're friends with Elvez, and he has a really great Christmas show. So he's kind of brought us on board to do shows with him and stuff like that. And it's fun because people can't wait till we're done so they can see him, but it's fine.
But the holidays are a great gimmick. People love the holidays, and even if they don't like Christmas, they like us because we basically make fun of the holidays. That's our thing. And so a lot of people just sort of thank us for saying the things that most people don't say out loud, but feel.
It all comes from a place of honesty. And if our families bothered to listen to any of our Christmas music, they might be like, wait a minute, that's me. But they don't listen, so we can pretty much say whatever we want. But it's true, you know, Christmas with old people or Christmas with drunk people, whatever. It's all in there, and it's all pretty much
He's
true.
He's maybe setting us up for our next song.
I'm not, but that's pretty good.
I mean, I definitely would say that the holidays give you some good content to make some good jokes that a lot of people can relate to. Do you prefer to do these holiday shows? Do you think that it's, like, more entertaining for you as performers?
I think so. Oftentimes there's just that emotional response from audience members. And sometimes Joe will dress in a Santa suit. I know we're on the radio, so people can't see us right now, but we're all decked out in shiny Christmassy outfits. And it's weird. Put a Santa suit on anyone and suddenly they're just like a magnet. And it's, you know, if I was wearing a Santa suit, people would think I was Santa. It's the magic of the Santa suit. So I just like, I like making people happy at the holidays.
Well, and then when you do a holiday show, pretty much everybody's in, you know, they're in a good mood. They want to have a good time. And they kind of dig the kind of anti-Christmas thing we do. And I think those are some of our best songs because there's so many Christmas songs and there's so many bad Christmas songs that you just have to know what to avoid. And you can kind of make fun of the, you know, the more popular ones, or you go, okay, well, we're inundated with Christmas songs, you know, after Halloween, so we're going to make it a little bit fun, and we're going to sing some inappropriate type, which has been going on forever. There's a ton of great, you know, Christmas parody, Christmas comedian, comic music, and it's fantastic, and it's, you know.
But if anyone saw the Thanksgiving Day parade, one would think that the Christmas music industry is in real big problem or real big danger right now. But we're here to bring some good
some
Christmas.
Indecency back to the holiday.
There you go. One critique I often will hear about, you know, holiday music is that it really is kind of the same songs every year over and over again. So I'm sure it's like very refreshing for you to perform songs people haven't heard, but also for your audiences to listen to something that they haven't heard before.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
We try not to do parodies, but if we do, they're pretty bad. You know, they're pretty. The newest one we have is God Rest Ye Mary Tyler Moore. And that's not like we haven't, it's only written, it hasn't been performed, but it's like, okay, if we're going to do a parody, it's going to be ridiculous. I think we do one of our songs tonight as a parody, maybe two.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
But yeah, it's Christmas. It's fun to do it. It's a fun time of year. We get to dress up, you know, and, you know, it's, yeah. Our other shows are boring. The rest of the year is terrible. No, it's not really, but kind of.
I feel like for the sake of our listeners, we just kind of have to describe this setup right now. We have a ton of red, sparkly costumes. It's very festive in here at Big Heavy World, so I just feel like listeners need to know that. But it seemed like you had a good segue based off our conversation onto your next song. So how about you play that for us?
Sounds good.
I don't even know what it is.
It's about family gatherings, and we actually had to... self-censor for this song. Yeah. So I will continuously try to remember to say the correct words.
The Wish song title itself had a bad word in it, so we had to change it up a bit. Okay. All right. This family
Christmas party gets worse year after year, and we think the reason is clear.
Are you ready, Jay?
Let's go! There's just too many jerks here at Christmas.
I can't believe this is my family.
Lots of people I don't know, this family seems to grow and grow. Who is having sex with jerks like these? Oh, this isn't how I celebrate the season. Who invited Todd and Mike and Keith? This house is full of grumps and chumps and idiots who voted Trump. Peace and love and the GOP.
There's just too many jerks here at Christmas.
I just want some peace and harmony. They all want to hold a grudge. Let's smoke some pot and eat some fudge and pass out underneath the Christmas tree.
Ready, Jay?
Ready.
Just too many jerks here at Christmas. The white elephant has entered hour three. Can't wait to get out of here, so I'm glad it's only once a year. This family stuff is just too much for me. So many places I would rather be. Something, something, something Christmas tree.
That's what we were talking about. Those type songs.
Exactly. So obviously you're doing the whole holiday theme, which obviously will go on until the holidays are over, I assume. Do you have any exciting gigs during this holiday season that we should kind of have our eyes open for?
We do. I just can't remember them.
The Highlight Festival.
Oh, the Highlight Festival on... New Year's Eve.
Yep.
We're doing that.
We're doing a virtual one. We did one last year as well, and it was a lot of fun. We never really performed live on Zoom before, and it was fun. So, and otherwise...
Apparently anything goes on those the highlight shows.
So we are still, open to possibilities for other shows, and we may even have a surprise show lined up. But
Ooh.
Let us have to see. You know, this world is a crazy place, and it's one day at a time.
Right. Like any good show, it depends on the variant that's going on at the time. So, you know, we'll let you know. But we are doing a virtual show December 12th. And basically, it's a show we used to do in Los Angeles, and now it's virtual, but which is cool because we're here. We wouldn't have gone out and played, so we just do a new video every year, and we submit that. And so that'll be in the show December 12th.
At CNC Studios, and all of this information can be found on our website, www.ponydeathride.com.
Dot. I'll be like, what's missing? And the odd thing, not the odd thing, but the neat thing about that is the song that we did this year, it's called It's a Tom Waits Christmas. And we got Billy Bratcher from the Starlight Rhythm Boys to play bass on it. So of the very few people we've met in Burlington, he's kind of the first. I think he greeted us at the state line as we drove,
there drove you go.
Through and was like, you're going to be my friend. So it's worked out, yeah. So, yeah, those are the only shows. And then our record, actually, we have a vinyl record that comes out December 10th, which is the Christmas album that is available on CD now, but we're doing it on vinyl because that's what the kids like. They like the pretty red records.
Right.
So December 10th, and we're doing it at Burlington Record Plant, and we're excited about that.
Yes, I love that vinyl's coming back. I myself got my own record player, and I just love that. So you kind of mentioned how COVID obviously impacted performing last year, but it seems like you've adapted to the whole virtual format. So how has that been? How did that affect everything in terms of how COVID affected you?
Well, we really just, I mean, we would play fairly regularly throughout the year prior to the pandemic. And so now it's much less frequent and it's online. And we are not very technically savvy people. So it's a little always, a little nerve-wracking, you know. Am I going to hit the wrong button or the battery's going to run
it's
out?
It's ridiculous. Yeah. We're so, that shows our age more than anything else is like being like, oh, it's a what? And we have to record. Okay. Like we just totally don't get the thing at all.
But I kind of like the just sort of staying home part and, you know, being having my own bathroom, not having to use a bathroom at a gig or whatever.
You can't be naked waist down at a gig. You can't. Home, yes.
Right.
Yes.
So
we don't, but you could.
Yeah, right. The vinyl is coming out December 10th, you said.
Yes.
Do you have any projects after the holidays that you're also working on currently or hoping to work on?
None. So we got to Burlington a little over a year ago, and as soon as we got here, we put out our fourth record. And that fourth record was pretty much all the material we had. We moved here, and then after about a couple of months, you know, we couldn't really go anywhere because of the COVID, and we just kind of drove around, like, what is Vermont, and where are we at? Like, Jade's been to Vermont, but I'd never been to practically the East Coast, so we were driving around. And then shortly after that, we opened a vintage store. Well, we got the space on a vintage store, so in Winooski. So music totally took a backseat, and so much so that we had to relearn these songs because we just hadn't played. For 10 straight years, we wrote songs, we played shows and recorded, and then all that just kind of came to an end. It's weird how you can't really get motivated during COVID. You know, there's not a lot of, you're not joking around a lot, like, oh, that's funny. But it's starting to come back a little bit, and we're kind of getting a couple new songs going. But it would be great to play shows around Burlington. It seems like it's and one of the reasons we moved out, I think, was, you know, based on the music. I mean, it had to have a good music scene wherever we moved, and this certainly does. So we like to get into it and play shows and stuff like that. So when that day's possible, do that. But until then,
we have a lot of CDs and a lot of T-shirts and other merch to sell. So we got to keep playing until we can unload some of that stuff.
We can't record because we don't have room for even more CDs. I don't know what we're going to do with a bunch of records either. But, you know.
Right.
Keep them in our van. I don't know.
So can you kind of talk us through, how did the ideas for the skits and the songs come to you? Like, what is your creative process? Do you think of the music before, or do you kind of have a concept of the jokes that you want to tell?
Well, a lot of it is improvised. I guess I can get bored easily, so we rarely do the same dialogue twice. We mix it up a lot, but it just comes from being lifetime fans of comedy and watching sketch comedy, Saturday Night Live. I'm Canadian, so SCTV, Kids in the Hall. So it's just sort of that absurd sense of humor. And we're definitely a little bit, I've said before, we sort of play characters that are just sort of exaggerated bad versions of ourselves. Like, we're pretty straight-laced people that we don't even drink very much, but the characters that we portray in our songs are people who have a lot of issues.
Or is it that we have those issues and we cover them up, and then when we write songs, it's like, oh, I can finally be myself.
Right.
A song about stalking or whatever. But it's, you know, it's funny, when the whole concept that we started was just based on writing goofy songs, and they were bad. And I'll come to Jay and I'll be, oh, I have this song. And she'll be like, no, that's really not going to be, we're not going to do that. And she'll clean it up. And then I was like, well, then she was like, and we're going to wear costumes. And I was like, no, that, what? And then she's like, okay, let me sit you down and tell you the history of, you know, comedic duos and musical performers and things like that. And this is what they do. And then I kind of went, oh, okay. And now I'm on board. So, you know, I'm always thinking of the
finally,
next.
After all these years.
Thinking of the next, you know. So, you know, who wants to see, well, I don't know. For what we do, we have to do something like that. We have to, come up with different skits or different songs, or you can't just play the songs with a sullen look on your face, because it doesn't, you know. It's like you have the songs and then you have the act as well, so, you know.
So in terms of improv-ing and the whole recording process, do you kind of keep tabs on, like, which improvs you like the most, and is that the one that would make the recording then?
Yeah, pretty much. It's also a lot about timing. Sometimes we just go in with sort of some loose ideas and then we manage to get them all in the certain allotted amount of bars and we're like, okay, great, it's a wrap. We're we don't like to overwork it. We like things to be spontaneous. And so, you know, we have a lot of witty banter between ourselves all day long, every day. So we know how to kind of just hone it down to a few.
We just throw some
few
chords,
meaningful lines.
Throw some chords to some witty banter, and that's the song.
There you go. And you said too that you have a vintage store, so clothing.
A little bit of clothing. It's a cat-themed vintage store. So we have all types of vintage items. The usual stuff: the books, records, dishes, knickknacks galore, but many of them come in the form of cats. Cat art, cat jewelry, cat everything. Cat salt and pepper shakers, of course.
Of course.
I'm a big proponent of the gimmick. So gimmicks help you stand out. And so in music and in retail, we are heavily reliant upon gimmicks.
Yeah, it's been great. We opened up 4 months ago in Winooski. We just kind of found this space, and it was the old cobbler shop, and we're like, yeah, let's spend 8 months taking the old wood off the walls of this place and then putting our stuff in there and see what happens. But it was COVID, so we had all the time in the world, and we were new here, so we didn't have any, we weren't going to hang out with anyone or anything. So it was great. We set it up, and it's been about 4 months, and it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, I imagine that having that kind of aspect of what you do, too, can kind of add to your performances as well. Have you found that sometimes, like, the vintage side of your personalities have contributed to your, either your writing or your skits or jokes?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've always liked old stuff, and so watched a lot of old comedy, Carol Burnett, The Muppet Show, all that stuff. So there's definitely, in the store is definitely a reflection of who we are as weird artsy musician types. We have musical instruments as well at the store occasionally, but I call it high kitsch. You know, we have a lot of weird stuff. It's not for everyone, but definitely it's all part of the same weird Jay and Joe Pony Death Ride package.
One story I have to share is that, so we don't know the Burlington music scene really at all, except for a few people. And the bands we've seen have been great. So this guy walks in and to the store about a month ago, and he's looking at this guitar. And, you know, he looked like he knew what he was doing. You know, he's looking at the guitar, he's playing a couple chords. And then Jay says, "Hey, are you in a local band?" And the guy said, "I'm in a band called Fish." And we're just both like, okay. And then I was like, "You're a real popular band," because I'm that witty and that quick. So the guy from Fish was there, and we're like, "Are you in a local band?" He was very nice, but it was just funny. It's like, we don't know that band. We should probably know that.
He was very nice, and then he got the hell out of
there. Then he got the hell out of there. He didn't want anything to do. If you don't know who I am in Burlington.
We didn't even get to tell him who we were. That was the bummer.
We're no one. So
we didn't get to load him down with any free CDs or any other things he didn't want. He just ran right out of there.
Yeah. So, yeah, that was pretty funny.
Oh my gosh. Well, we would love to hear your third song from you. So what have you got for us?
What do we have? Your baby.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. This song features Jay on the $20 Toys R Us Glockenspiel. We have purchased more expensive Glockenspiels, and we've sold them all because this one is the winner of the bunch. And it's sad that Toys R Us closed because we can't get another one. Oh, we got it at Target.
Huh. That's a cat keyboard.
Where were we? One, two, three, one, two, three.
Christmas is here and another year's through. We're so happy to spend it with you. Let's gather with friends like most adults do, to drink and to make fun of Jesus. Well, Christmas, it seems a bit different this year. There's a little more poop and a little less cheer. We'll say it twice just to make ourselves clear. Your baby is ruining our Christmas.
When you RSVP'd, there was no plus one. You see anyone else in a diaper?
We said bring a fruitcake and you brought your son. We're not saying he's not cute as hell, but he'll be cute on Boxing Day as well. Christmas, it seems a bit different this year. There's a little more breastfeeding, a little less cheer. People are leaving and it's become clear. Your baby is ruining our Christmas.
Deal with the baby.
You saw that, right?
Saw it. I heard it, and I also smelled it.
You put a flyer out, you send it to your friends, you put a baby on that flyer with a circle and a big slash through it. It means no babies.
I know. Everyone thinks their baby is special.
Well, have you seen this baby? He's
probably a little
special, you know. But this year was what year was this? Pantsless Christmas.
Oh, that's right. All year, pantsless Christmas.
I was going to cover myself up in Crisco oil and just freak out on everybody, and not this year. Got a baby.
Yeah, that's too bad.
What about all the pot brownies, huh?
Oh, God. What are we going to do with all of them?
That's too many pot brownies to have around a baby.
Well, I guess we're just going to have to feed them to the dogs.
Oh, that's a little bit harsh.
Oh, no.
Oh, the brownies.
Yeah, okay. No, but hey, okay. I like your style.
Thank you. And see that we had the mistletoe this year. That can't happen because a little pervy baby's going to be... Things change. Baby. All the rules have changed now that person brought their baby.
Babies ruin it for everyone.
Thanks, baby.
This isn't the party that we had in mind. 3 hours watching him open presents. Leave him in the car, well, sure, he'll be fine.
That's my wife's idea.
Oh, no, that was my husband's idea.
Okay, it was both our ideas that he should go. Christmas, it seems a bit different this year. There's a little more crying, a little less cheer. You've turned our party into a daycare. Your baby is ruining our Christmas. Christmas, it seems a bit different this year.
There's a lot more poop.
There's a lot more poop.
There's an awful amount of poop at this Christmas party.
I think they brought it in. I saw them bringing in some trash bags from their car. Disgusting.
Yeah, something's wrong with that kid.
And a little less cheer. We'll say it twice just to make ourselves clear. Your baby is ruining our Christmas.
Wow, 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 wow. Too soon.
There we go.
Thank you, everybody.
Yay. Sorry, friends with babies.
Yeah, right?
We told you.
We're just doing a public service for anyone who's having a party and doesn't want anyone to bring their baby and ruin it.
We are the voice of people that your friends don't want you to bring a baby to the Christmas party. And we don't have kids, so we can say these things for other people. It's a service. It's a Christmas service we offer to people.
I was going to ask if that was a personal narrative or if...
They're all personal narratives, and it's up to the listener to figure out who it's about. which friend of ours it's about, because they're all about friends.
So I would love to hear a bit more about your recording process. So what is the process there? Do you reach out to somebody for help with recording? Do you do some yourself?
Oh, we can't do anything. We're totally useless. So we go into a professional studio, and we were lucky to find this guy named Mike Camus, Earthling Studios in San Diego. Joe's previous band, Trophy Wife, recorded with them, and he's just amazing. And he's like, he's sort of the third member of the band. It was probably harder to move away from Mike Camus than most things about San Diego. But he just kind of gets us. He ends up playing a lot of the other instruments. He's our drummer, and he adds little bits and pieces of guitar here and there and really helps to fill it out. And somehow we come with these crazy little ideas, and he seems to know what we're talking about and make them happen. Because
yeah, it could probably, for any other like engineer recording person, it would probably be really annoying to be in the studio with us, because we're one or two takes and we're done. It doesn't even have to be perfect if we're close, because you know, we prepare, we practice, and then we go in there and it's just done. But we spend an inordinate amount of time, throwing like little samples in and little goofy, you know, things from old records or whatever. And it's so much fun. And he just sits there and just goes along with it. And we're like, no, do, but make this sound like this. And you see his eyes roll. But then we buy him dinner and he's fine. But yeah, so he plays all the drums, and so without him, we just couldn't. I'd still be recording on that little square tape recorder with the cassette on it, the little plain record, which is how we started recording most of our things. But yeah, the studio is great. We just get weird and wild and do all kinds of weird ideas and samples and things like that. So it's fun. It's fun. Then we come out here and we just have this and this, and it's a little boring, but you know, the records are where it's at. And we've sold dozens of records over the years, so those people know.
Out of the writing process, the recording process, or just performing in general, do you have a favorite one of those, or do you kind of just appreciate each of them?
I enjoy recording. I get really nervous about it before we go in there, but I always enjoy it. And I mean, some of my favorite moments of recording are the parts where things aren't going very well. We like to bring in session musicians, and usually we think, yeah, they know what they're doing, and they come in, and suddenly the people like forget how to play their instruments. That seems to happen very often, and so we've had some pretty hilarious episodes of trying to coax out of people what we want them to play, or sometimes their talents are just maybe overhyped, and so it's been challenging. But we also have a lot of good musicians who have come in and perform, you know, done songs for us or perform tracks. And Joe's even recorded a guy in his car once who didn't have time to come in to the studio. He was playing a gig, and so during the break they went into his car.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
And recorded some trumpet in the car.
I'm not good at vetting people, so if someone's like, well, in elementary school I played saxophone, and I'm like, great, come into the studio and we'll pay you money to be there. And then we're like, oh man.
Worse than us. Yeah, I play accordion. That's
no. What if that guy listens to this? He's a good friend.
We love that guy.
We do. Okay. Just not as accordion. So yeah, recording is a real, real blast. And having this guy, you know, having a really good engineer makes it fun. Somebody who's not gonna lose their patience, or they're gonna put up with our shenanigans, which is a lot to put up with. So when we record again, we would think we would go back to San Diego and record. But if we do have to record a song here, we just hope that somebody is.
Well, we've recorded all our songs, so fortunately,
we'll
never have to do that.
Yeah.
So it's great.
Yeah. No more records. You got four to choose from. Buy one of those.
I also have to ask, because I'm sure that there is there a story behind your name, Pony Death Ride?
Not really.
No.
Just as people who love music and have been in bands, it's just one of those things I think a lot of people do. They just sort of shout out random words and say, that would be a good band name. And so that was, I remember walking down the stairs of our old place in San Diego and saying, Pony Death Ride, that would be a good good name for a band. It's a mashup of Pony Ride and Death Ride. So, you know, it leaves a lot to the imagination.
We're both of those things.
Scary and cute.
I'm the scary one. But yeah, so Jay's like, okay, I think Pony Death Ride is the name of the band. Much like she said, hey, I think we should move to Burlington, Vermont. And I'm like, yeah, okay. All right, whatever. Yeah. It's fine.
Just go along with it, right?
Let's go along with it.
Yeah. It'll all work out in the end.
It has.
I'm really glad it worked out because I really talked up Burlington. Joe'd never been here before.
I Googled it. I did the little follow your street on the map type thing. I did that. That seemed okay.
I like that. So,
and we were here. I do have to quickly say we were here probably a week, and we had this composter in the yard. And we're like, we don't need this. Do we? Maybe. I don't know. Let's give it away. And so this guy calls and he shows up and he picks up this composter and he's like, I'm from Big Heavy World. And I'm like, oh, okay. I don't know what that is, but
that
great.
That was our first introduction
to
you folks.
And that's why we're here today, because of a free composter.
There you go.
Who was that?
I wonder.
Tom?
That was you?
That was you?
Jim.
Hey, Jim. Jim. And then Jim said, you really got, maybe they'll have you on Rocket Shop one day. That he said that, and we're here.
I feel like that could make some good content for a song about Vermont composting culture.
Nothing rhymes with composter. Skip toaster, but.
I mean, I feel like you could think of it.
Somebody write that down.
Yeah, right. So what we also like to do is, before we let you play your last song here, tell us how we can find your music, where we can find everything that has to do with helping us to help you out and promote you.
Okay. Well, with a name like Pony Death Ride, we're pretty easy to find. Aren't too many other Pony Death Rides on the internet. We've got that whole market pretty much.
If there is, avoid it.
We've got the whole market of Pony Death Rides dominated on the internet. And so we've got the usual ponydeathride.com website, as well as Facebook. Do we have an Instagram?
Bandcamp. We have an Instagram. All the stuff the kids do. We have all that stuff. We're easy to find.
Yeah.
We're not hiding.
CD Baby, they have our stuff, but it's everywhere. It's streaming. It's
trunk of our car.
It's on Spotify.
It's available. Yeah, we are on Spotify. Yeah.
Apple.
These are all big things
Apple
for us
music.
To be on these things.
You can actually just say, Alexa, play Pony Death Ride. It works. We tried it. We don't have one, but we tried it on someone else's.
All right. Well, what do you have for us for your last song tonight?
This is a parody. I don't know. It's called Hobby Lobby Christmas.
It's a weird day to be doing it, not to bring the tone down or anything of the party, but it's about women's reproductive rights, like all good holiday songs should be.
And how Hobby Lobby gives millions of dollars. You didn't know we were political. Gives millions of dollars to places that want to stop these things.
All right.
Well, so we don't go there.
Lay it on them.
We're a Michaels crowd. Until we find out something they do.
I'm sure they are not innocent. Anything. Okay.
Watch. All right. What is it? Oh, yeah. Okay. That's good.
Oh, hey, Joe. Why the sad face?
I just got a lot on my mind. I know it's Christmas time and I'm supposed to be happy, but I just can't right now.
Oh, well, why? What are you worried about?
Birth control, obviously. What else?
You don't have to worry about that. It's, you know, thanks to Hobby Lobby.
Wait a minute. Hobby Lobby? What does the arts and crafts place have to do with birth control?
Oh, you don't know?
No.
Well, thanks to Hobby Lobby, all our birth control decisions will be made for us.
Thanks Hobby Lobby.
Have a Hobby Lobby Christmas. This time of year is swell. Arts and crafts and your vagina, these things we know so well. Have a Hobby Lobby Christmas. And when you walk down the street, try not to have intercourse with everyone you meet. Ho, ho, you're such a ho. At least that's our belief. Instead of taking birth control, just keep it in your briefs. Have a Hobby Lobby Christmas. Your birth control's our choice. Too bad that you're a woman, 'cause it means you have no voice. Ho, ho, you're such a ho. At least that's our belief. Instead of taking birth control, just keep it in your brief. Have a Hobby Lobby Christmas. And in case you didn't hear, oh my golly, have a Hobby Lobby.
Non-compliant.
Pseudoscience.
Contraception.
Misconception.
Christmas this year.
That's it.
Well, thank you, you guys.
This has been a lot of fun. Thank you so much.
Yes. Pony Death Ride, thank you so much for joining us. This has been Rocket Shop on 105.9 FM, The Radiator. I'm your host, Abby BK, filling in for Tom Proctor this evening. And we hope you have a wonderful holiday. Thank you for tuning in and good night.
Woohoo!
Yay!
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 That's it.
See.